Okay, welcome everyone to my series, What Are My Favorite Theorems? As usually, just by a sample, because we're talking about my favorite theorems, of course. In this video, I want to discuss the Perron-Frobenius theorem, or let's say the art of leading terms, you will see. This is a theorem actually of linear algebra, and it's really a working horse. It's so powerful. You can apply it to so many different setups. And it's a little bit surprising that people usually don't learn it in the class of linear algebra. The reason is probably because the proof needs methods that are beyond usually what you'll see in linear algebra. But anyways, the statement is part of linear algebra. It's extremely easy. It's extremely useful and powerful, and I love it so much. So let's just jump right into it. So I have here a reasonably random matrix. By what I mean is, this is whatever, a 10 by 10 matrix with entries from 0 to 9. And I've chosen them created this matrix using a random generator. So this is a reasonably random matrix. Whenever you have a random matrix, you shouldn't expect any patterns, right? It's random, it's reasonably random. But the fun thing is, strange patterns arise, and that's kind of the essence, and this will be the Perron-Frobenius theorem. So here are strange patterns with the eigenvalues and eigenvectors arise. So in this plot here, you see the eigenvalues of that matrix, and they are complex numbers. So of course, so this is like the complex plane, and I just plotted the eigenvectors. And the things to observe is, you have a leading eigenvector, eigenvalue. It's huge. It's much bigger than everything else. That's something like 45 something. And it's leading. It's real, positive, and much bigger than anything else. And that's already pretty surprising if you think about it, because it's kind of a random matrix. But it gets much better. So you also have a leading eigenvector. So the eigenvector for this eigen value is it can be scaled such it is completely positive. It has only real entries, all of them are positive. And what on earth is going on? Right? So we have a positive eigenvalue, you have a positive eigenvector, and they're leading in a certain sense. So that's already strange, because you're considering like a random matrix. But it gets even better. So you have certain patterns along the eigen for the eigenvalues. So like here, you see like those four things kind of lie on a circle, right? So strange patterns. Strange patterns, a positive leading eigenvector, a positive leading eigenvalue. So this can't be a coincidence, because you just picked out a 10 by 10 matrix with reasonably random entries. Okay, so that's probably what Perron-Frobenius thought something like 110 years ago. 110 years if you watch this video in 2021. This is weird. This is surprising. And something surprising usually leads to a beautiful theorem. And they played around with those things a little bit more. So here, the same kind of random matrix, and you get the same kind of patterns, right? So there is a leading eigenvector. Eigenvalue, it's here, and it has a only positive eigenvector, it's here, and you have this kind of strange symmetry of things tend to lie on a circle around the origin. Okay, that's pretty good. So you can feed in your favorite matrix like this. You can have numbers between one and whatever you like, and you will see this better. But if you feed in this random matrix here, and here I've chosen my entries between minus 9 and 9, so it's negative or it's not positive, then you get the pattern breaks. So there is no leading eigenvalue. There is no leading eigenvector. I don't see anything. So maybe it's about positive versus negative entries. And yes, it will be. So far what we know, or what we have seen, is if you take a random, reasonably random, any basically matrix, right? With a random matrix, kind of take any matrix with positive entries or non-negative entries, to be precise, so zero is totally fine. Then you get those nice patterns with a leading eigenvalue, a leading eigenvector, and some strange circle things around your origin. And if you do something negative, then things break. Okay, this is already pretty good. I've chosen a random matrix. And the random matrix is basically any matrix, except for certain matrices you can construct, right? You can always construct counterexamples. So the next slide is to rule them out. There's a certain type of counterexamples, and then I will have some precise statement. So the idea is as follows, and it goes back to Frobenius. So you can write down a graph for each of those matrices. So here's a matrix with only non-negative entries, right? So I have 0, 3, 8, 0, whatever. And you can write down a graph, and it's pretty easy. So you write a vertex for each column or row in your square matrix, and you write an edge if you see a non-zero entry. So here's an edge from two to one, and it's this entry in the matrix. It's a 2-1 entry in the matrix. The 1-2 entry in the matrix. Okay, and well, you can make it labeled, so you can write a number 3 here, and then you get a number 3 here. So let's do another example. Let's look at this entry. A 2, this should be, so this is the third vertex. This should be an edge of label 2 from the third vertex to the fourth. And yes, there is, here you go. Here it is, an edge of label 2, and so on. For example, this entry is this loop here on 3, again of label 2. And it's not hard to see that this is actually a one-to-one correspondence between matrices with positive integral entries or non-negative integral entries and graphs. So each of these matrix secretly is actually a graph. And you say a matrix is irreducible, and that's the terminology used by Frobenius, if its associated graph is strongly connected. And strongly connected is, so irreducible is a slight, if you look up the algebraic definition, it's a slightly weird condition, but For graphs, it's a very natural condition. Namely, it just means the graph is connected in the oriented sense, meaning that when you're at vertex, whatever, you can always find a path, whatever, to another vertex, right? In the oriented sense, following the orientation of the edges. That's called strongly connected, right? So a graph is strongly connected if you can go from any vertex to any other, and the matrix is irreducible if its graph is strongly connected. And this graph, so this graph above here is strongly connected. This graph is not, for example. And the only difference between those two graphs is that I have removed one of those edges. And you can see now that you will never be able to leave 4, right? Because in the oriented sense, there's no way to leave 4. While on the other one, I was able to go from 4 to 3, and from 3, I can basically go anywhere, which is, well, for example. And from 1, I can go to 2, to 4, and to 3. And from 2, I can go to 4, to 3. So you can go from 3, you can go everywhere. And from everywhere, you can go to 3. Well, that's strongly connected. So the only condition I want for my matrices is basically that its associated graph is connected. And then you get this. Of course, if you take a random graph with a lot of edges, then it will be strongly connected anyway. And enter the theorem. So the precise statement, whatever, don't read it too much, I will unravel it for you, is you have this matrix, which is irreducible, and it has non-negative entries. Okay? And then there exists a unique eigenvector, eigenvalue, the PF eigenvalue. PF is Perron-Frobenius. Which is real and bigger than 0, and whose absolute value is bigger than those of any other eigenvalue. So even the absolute value, right? So there could be some complex roots, but the leading one will always be the biggest. And this is my leading eigenvalue, the Perron-Frobenius eigenvalue. That's already pretty amazing, but the theorem gets much better. It So this is unique. It also says there's this unique eigenvector, the PF eigenvector, for this eigenvalue, of course, whose entries are all positive, and this is a leading eigenvector. And this is the only positive eigenvector. Okay, so it's a leading eigenvector, it's unique. Both of these are unique. So this was the leading, and, well, finally, the only eigenvectors with the same absolute value as my PF are around the circle. So here's an example. So if you have this graph, which is obviously strongly connected, which just goes in a circle, then the associated eigenvalues just also go just in the circle. And you have five of them, and they all lie on a circle, and this is my PF eigenvalue. They're all of the same size. They're all lying on a circle. They're all of the same absolute value. But the PF is the only real one among them, the only positive real one among them. And this was this pattern you have seen before, just kind of shifted to the other eigenvalues. Okay, so this is pretty amazing. So all of these things have a nice symmetry, or nice symmetries and nice patterns going on. There's a leader for the eigenvalues, there's a leader for the eigenvectors, and there's this funny circular symmetry within the eigenvalues itself. Pretty amazing theorem. And it's a working horse. So let me show you a pretty funny application of the Perron-Frobenius theorem. So it's a real world application. So let's consider the question whether a population will go extinct. And what you usually do is, if you have such questions, you come up with a model and you try to solve the model. Of course, the model will always only be an approximation to the reality, but that's the best science can do anyway. So the model is pretty easy. So you have a population, and you divide your population into age groups. And I denote them by X1, X2, X3, and so on. So you can, for example, divide them by decades. So people, let's say, between age 10 and 20, between age 20 and 30, and so on. Okay, so the X's here, those guys, are just how many people do you have in a certain age group? And you want to answer the question, what happens if time flies. So the superscript J here is just meaning that I'm considering the J snapshot in time. Okay, so I kind of want to study the limit of the system. So if J is infinity. And the equation you need to solve in this model is the following. So we have a transition matrix. I will explain the matrix in a second. And the transition matrix is basically explaining, this M matrix here, is basically explaining how the transition between the different age groups work. So the entries of the matrix are as follows. So the first row, this is something that multiplies with the first vector and ends in the lowest age group. So this is just the reproduction. So each age group has a certain percentage of the reproduction system, and the newborn individual will of course be of the lowest age group. So the first row is the reproduction. And then this diagonal along here is a transition from one stage to the other, the probability that you transition from one stage to the other. And you can see it easily, let's say, because this row, if you multiply it to the matrix, will exactly pick out this entry and send it to here, and so on. Okay, so a matrix, first row, the reproduction of each age group, and this lower diagonal is the transition. And do you want to study what happens in this process? J is my snapshot, J goes to infinity, right? And it turns out that Frobenius Perron knows the answer to everything, almost. So this is my matrix M. And it turns out this beautiful theorem, if my Perron-Frobenius eigenvalue is bigger than one, then the population will grow without limit. If my Perron-Frobenius eigenvalue is smaller than one, then the population will actually become extinct, or population will, well, die. And the only uncertainty is you don't really know what happens, or you a priori don't know what happens if BF is one. But I think this is a pretty cool application. So it's a reasonable model of population, right? And the only thing you need to know is that you need to compute a certain eigenvalue of Perron-Frobenius. And that this works is as a consequence of Perron-Frobenius theorem. So I hope you like the Perron-Frobenius theorem as much as I do. And it basically says, well, there's a leading term, look at the leading term, and that's amazing. Okay, hope to see you next time.